Are you interested in a career in consulting? Most people that I know that interview for consulting roles have one thing that they are most scared of, and this is the case interview. So welcome to another video here on my channel Firm Learning. My name is Heinrich, I'm a former McKinsey consultant, and today let me share a couple of case interview tips. And specifically, we're going to look into the three main components of most case interviews. First, the qualitative part, second, the data reasoning part, and third, the quantitative part. So surely formats differ firm by firm, but I'd argue that these things are part of most of these case interview formats. So let's get into it. The purpose of the case interview in a consulting interview process is to test how comfortable you are with situations that you will face as a consultant. So the interviewer will present you with a little business problem and then expect you to solve it. Sometimes in a more unstructured way, sometimes we're going over a specific set of questions that the interviewer has prepared for you. And one key part that is often the case in these interviews is what I like to call data reasoning. And this means that at some point in the interview, the interviewer will show you a chart, will give you a handout. If it's a video interview, often will just share his or her screen to show you some data visualization. And of course, this is what you will be faced with quite frequently. You will work with lots of data in consulting. And the key question is, how good are you? How effective are you at interpreting this data and getting insights out of it? So let's look into an example. Let's imagine the interviewer would show you this exhibit, and the case context is that you are asked to look into opportunities for this company to grow its revenue and its profit over the next years. And now you're looking at this chart, and the interviewer might ask you, well, what do you see here? What do you make of this? Any implications you can draw from this? And in my humble opinion, in situations like those, there are three quality levels of answers that candidates give you. Let's start with the lowest quality level, the lowest level of insight. And this is just restating the facts. So surely if you look at a slide like this, you see lots of facts. You see, for instance, in year one, that product A had net sales of 100 euro million, and that 20 million units of product A were sold in year one, and that the company made a profit of 20 million in that year. And some candidates will tell you just that. Some candidates will just read out things that you can clearly read on your slide anyway, and just tell you what exactly the numbers are that they see there. And of course, I hope you understand that this is not the best answer. This is really stating the obvious, stating the things that everybody can say by just reading the slide. So this is the first level of insight. Let's get to the second level of insight. And this is providing a qualified summary. Let's call it this way. So people look at the information and do give you some good insights. Maybe they're able to conclude that, well, product A stayed constant from year one to year two, so no changes. Or maybe they were able to conclude that product B doubled in sales, so from 150 million in year one to 300 million in year two. Or that maybe product C actually is declining by apparently more than 15% here in riding sales year on year. So this would be a second information. It's a restatement of facts, a condensation of the information that you get, and then restating this as a little qualified summary for the interviewer. And surely this is already much better, right, than just reading out the facts. But I would argue there's one thing that really the most stellar candidates do, the most outstanding candidates do, that is beyond just providing a summary. And this is really looking into the insights, into the implications of what you see here. Well, it might be the case that this is how the products are, that this is how they're developing, but what does this really mean for the case question at hand? What do you really make out of that, right? This, I think, is the main question. So always think back to the original case question. What did the interviewer ask you to actually look at? Where the question was, how can this company increase revenue and profit over the next years? So with this information in mind, what do you make out of this? And I think here it's one crucial thing that you need to understand, that product C seems to be the most important product for that company in regards to the revenue, but also in regards to the profit. But product C is declining. Revenues are down, profit are down, right? And while it is true that product B is growing, this is not even overcompensated the loss the product C is making. So this is really a problem that this company is having. You really need to investigate what is going on with product C. Why isn't it performing that well anymore? Because if we don't fix this, it will be very difficult for this company. And this is exactly what the stellar candidate would have been able to draw out, to see this, to find this implication, to find this so what, and then link it back to the case question. Don't just restate some facts, don't just summarize things, but make it clear what the implications of that are for the manager, for the CEO, for your client tomorrow. Show that you're able to see this. Next is the quantitative part of the interview. So surely in consulting, you will work with data, with numbers a lot, and it's always great that the interviewer will look for that, whether you're comfortable with numbers, whether you're good at calculations. And here my first tip would be, before you even get a math question for the interviewer, try to show whenever it makes sense that you're really comfortable with the numbers. So here, staying with this example, it would have been great that without even getting a question, that you would have just calculated, for instance, the unit price that this company sells the products to. So for instance, product A, you can always divide net sales by units sold, then 100 over 20 would mean a unit price of €5. Or for product B, 150 over 60 would be a unit price of €2.5. Or product C, 480 over 240 would be a unit price of €2, right? So 5, 2.5, and 2. And by doing that, you could have then also compared whether the pricing would have changed between year 1 and year 2. Because this, of course, might have also influenced how the different numbers changed year on year. And if you did this, you would have realized that the pricing did not change. The price stayed constant over time. A similar thing that you could just have calculated, which would have been strong if you just mentioned this without even anybody asking you for that, is just the profit margins for these different products. So here for product A, 20 million profit over 100 million sales would be a profit margin of 20%. Product B with 30 over 150 would also have been a profit margin of 20%. But then product C, 240 over 480, here you can see that this is a profit margin of 50%, right? So 20, 20, 50. And this would have just stressed and underlined your point of saying that this company really has a significant issue, because product C really is the most profitable one, not only in absolute numbers, but also in relative numbers, providing a profit margin of 50% for every unit of this product C that the company is selling. Doing calculations like that with mental math is, of course, very confident, very strong, shows that you know what you're doing and really have all the numbers in order. What interviewers like to do is then ask you to do some calculations, often also with numbers provided on a chart exhibit like this one. Here you need to know that usually you're only allowed to work with pen and paper, which means that you should practice written multiplication, written division before you walk into the interview. Because even if you are good at math, often more complex calculations, if you're not practiced with doing them on pen and paper without calculator, often you will really mess up the calculations, and this is surely what you should avoid. And here also be ready to do these calculations up to the first or second or third decimal point. Sometimes interviewers just want to see that you are able to really get these calculations right, also to the first or second decimal. Make sure you can do that, because this might be expected from you. The third area I want to talk about is the qualitative part of the case interview. Here it will be about structuring a problem into its issues, into its drivers or other aspects that are relevant. So in the context of this little example here for today, the interviewer might ask you to come up with all the relevant drivers and decision factors that influence the ability of the company to really increase its revenue and profit over the next years. This is a typical business-related structuring question. And here now the key thing is, of course, to have a structure that you use to not just engage in a brainstorming mood, but to show that you are able in a repeatable way to create insights like that. And one big error that many people do is that they get all these books with all these case prep frameworks and the learn 30, 40, 50, 60 frameworks or so by heart, believing that just the more frameworks they know, the better, and they just need to learn the perfect framework for every individual case that exists out there just to be fine. But this, of course, is quite dangerous, because it's very likely that the case that you will get just will not fit any specific framework that you memorized. So I would not recommend you to learn all these frameworks like that, but I do think it is worthwhile to learn a handful of frameworks which you will be able to use quite often. And I think here for these qualitative purposes, probably the most powerful one is a business situation type of framework. So framework that you can use to structure and analyze different factors that affect business decisions. And here one very well known one is the so-called 3C framework or the 3C model. So company, customer, competition. So for instance, if you would now analyze this specific case, you would first want to learn more about the company, your client. So what are the capabilities of the employees? How does the organization look like? In what countries are they active? How does their product portfolio look like? What's the pricing looking like? And so on and so forth. So more internal factors. Second, customers. Right? So what different customer segments exist, what are their preferences, which segments are growing, which are declining, and so on and so forth. And then third, competition. So what is your market share? How does this maybe differ by region? How does your product compare to their products? What are the differentiating factors, USPs that you have compared to them? So just a couple of factors that you can always go over in these situations. An adaptation from that I always liked really to use is to use this, but then discuss product in a separate bucket, in a separate area. Because the problem that I feel like a bit if you use company, customer, competition is this, that this is just so widely used, so widely known, that often the interviewer will just get a bit bored, right? If you start with this, just because probably every second or every third candidate will have a framework like that. And for this specific reason, I do think it also makes sense that maybe you want to think about your own version of organizing these factors, just to make it a little bit more innovative, just to not make it seem like the same structure that you just learned by heart that everyone else is using. Last but not least on this point, what's also important is how you present it. And here my key advice is to present in a top-down way. Top-down communication is what it's all about. And if you have no clue at all what this means, I will link another video above here where I explain this concept in detail. But specifically for this idea is what you need to do. Always first start by presenting the first level, then the second level, then the third level, and so on, right? So when you now present your structure, start by saying, okay, I looked into three things. First, the company, second, customer, third, competition. You explain the structure. Then you go into the first bucket. So let's start with the company. In the company, I have these elements I'd like to talk about. Element one, element two, element three, element four. So let's go into element one. This is what this is about. Element two, this is what this is about. So always keep the pyramid principle in mind. This other concept I also talk about in this other video. Being well structured and well organized is one of the most important skills in consulting. In the interviewer, we'll look for exactly this skill, specifically here in the question types where it's about qualitative structuring of factors. And last but not least, I promise you that in the end, I will share the one tip which I think really makes the difference for me and also for many other people that I know that successfully prepared for consulting case interviews. And this key point is doing practice cases with other people. Do practice cases with other people who also prepare for their consulting case interviews. And the key problem that also I had at the time is, of course, to find other people, because surely you don't just want to do this with everyone, but with someone who knows is really good and can really help you. And for this reason, I'm very happy to introduce you to PrepLaunch, a company that I'm partnering with and that is also sponsoring this video. Because PrepLaunch is a case interview preparation platform that helps candidates to really prepare for their interviews to make sure that they can ace the interview process of any of these leading consulting firms like McKinsey, BCG, or Bain. I absolutely believe that the most important aspect of preparing for case interviews is really to become comfortable with solving complex problems just in the atmosphere that you would also find in real case interview situations. And for me, it seems obvious that this can only be achieved by practicing cases as much as possible and receiving feedback from real case partners. And this is where PrepLaunch comes into play, because they bring together aspiring consultants, management consultants from around the world to do just that, just to practice cases. PrepLaunch offers you a vast case library, interactive content, personalized training plans for your preparation, and what's probably best is that you can match with other people who are also currently preparing for their case interviews and do mock cases with each other to improve both of your skills. In addition to that, you can also book sessions with current or former consultants from, for instance, MBB firms, also other consulting firms, and they will coach you and work together with you to improve your case interview game. So if you're interested to that, check out the link to PrepLaunch in the video description. Sign up is completely free. There is also premium membership though, below if you want to have access to some of the advanced functionalities and features. But what's great is that PrepLaunch also provided a discount code to the firm learning community. So with the code Heinrich15, you get 15% off on the premium membership. I will include the link in the description as well. So just check this out if this feels of value to you. So if you have any other questions on your case interview preparation, please leave me a comment in the comment section. If you took any value out of this video at all, please hit the like button for the YouTube algorithm and subscribe. My name is Heinrich. I release videos every single Saturday. Big thanks to all the members of the channel. You're really making a difference. So see you again next week. Until then, bye bye.